Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 2625 in the name of Patrick Harvey on a new deal for tenants. I'd invite members who wish to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Patrick Harvey to speak to and move the motion. I've got a point of order from Edward Mountain.
I don't know if you can hear me, but my point of order is simple. At the debate last week, I asked if I could make an intervention from it being virtual. Not by choice that I'm virtual, it is by necessity that I'm virtual. And I've notified the presiding officers that I feel marginalised, that I cannot intervene in debates. I have now scrolled through the minutes of the Bureau meetings to try and identify where it was agreed that virtual members would not be able to intervene or make intervention in debates. I can find no reference to it. Presiding officer, I ask if you could guide me to the correct minute so that I can see where it has been agreed that virtual members cannot make intervention or join in debates if they are not speaking. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I can thank you for your point of order. I can advise you that within the guidance on hybrid meetings that was circulated to all members, that point was made clear. I can also advise Mr. Mountain and indeed the Chamber that the issue about being able to make interventions or take interventions remotely is something that the Bureau is looking at, I think, very seriously and with a degree of urgency. And in fact, the Chief Executive, I understand, updated the Finance Committee this morning in terms of developments. There is no imminent breakthrough in relation to this. I understand the frustration and every step is being taken to try and address those concerns, Mr. Mountain. Now, with that, we move on to the next item of business. As I say, I call on Patrick Harvey to speak to and move the motion for around 10 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm really delighted to be able to do so. I've taken part in housing debates over many years in this chamber, and I've often, during those debates, taken the opportunity to reflect on my own experience of renting a home. I've known good landlords who act responsibly, but I've also known high rents and poor maintenance. I've been harassed out of a flat by an abusive landlord, and I can still remember the shock of learning, when I could eventually afford to buy a home, just how much more I'd been paying to rent a room and kitchen than it cost to have a mortgage on an entire two-bedroom flat. So I know very well from personal experience that Scotland's tenants need a new deal, and I'm really delighted now that I have the opportunity to propose action to Parliament. The 700,000 people who rent privately need a new deal to give them the freedom to turn a house into a home, to better protect them from eviction, to challenge excessive rents, and to assure them that authorities will take action if their landlord steps over the line. Over a million people who rent from a council, a housing association, or a co-op need a new deal to keep on improving access to housing and drive up standards as we tackle the twin challenges of fuel poverty and climate change. And together, all of the people who rent need a new deal that helps them be better informed, more meaningfully engaged, and better able to exercise their rights. A new deal that centres firmly on housing as a human right. And that's why the draft New Deal for Tenants, which we announced yesterday, is a new deal for all tenants. And it's why Housing to 2040 earlier this year pledged to develop a whole rented sector strategy. It also incorporates the ambitions for the rented sector strategy that was set out in the shared policy programme between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Greens. Now, for work on this scale of ambition, we need to hear from many perspectives. So over the last few months, I've met with senior councillors and staff, with tenants' unions, landlords, housing associations, campaigners, letting agents. But above all, I think the government needs to hear more from tenants themselves. That's why we're working with the Joseph Rowntree Foundation whose expertise has been very helpful for us in engaging with private rented sector tenants. I've already committed to establishing a tenant participation panel for the private rented sector, the first of its kind to ensure tenants' voices are front and centre. And I'm seeking views on how we can support the development of tenants' unions and other ways of engaging with tenants. And early in the new year, we'll also be launching a new publicity campaign to make sure that tenants know their rights. So I believe that a whole sector approach is required so that all tenants can expect value for money and good housing standards. Housing systems are integrated, neighbourhoods and even buildings are mixed, and each sector can learn from the other. However, I recognise that for private renters in particular, there is a power imbalance where tenants are less able to exercise their rights and still have less secure tenancies than in the social sector. Therefore, many of the specific policy proposals I'm seeking views on in this consultation are for private renting. That's why I've set out proposals for the introduction of a new housing bill in the second year of this Parliament, a new regulator for the private rented sector to enforce standards and work toward a national system of rent controls for the private rented sector by beginning to put in place the evidence framework that's needed. However, I know that there is more to be done for social tenants too, and so we're also consulting on a number of things to support them, including creating a new housing standard and regulating to set minimum standards for energy efficiency and zero emissions heating for all homes, and exploring what further action we can take to ensure that rents in the social rented sector are affordable. I think I heard an intervention from over here, first of all.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
And thank you, Minister, for taking the intervention, which seems to be a popular thing to do at this point. Tomorrow, approximately 14 people will be in court in Glasgow by housing associations, and it's possible that that's as a result of evictions. You and I have both campaigned strongly against winter evictions. Would you consider bringing forward immediate regulations to Parliament to end winter evictions so that nobody has to be evicted in a house, in particular in this period when they could be asked to self-isolate at home, where, of course, you couldn't self-isolate if you didn't have a home?
Please, interventions through the chair, but Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will be coming on to winter evictions later, and I think Pam Duncan-Glancy knows that some of the temporary measures during the coronavirus pandemic are to be made permanent around discretion at the tribunal. But I hope she understands that I'm not able to comment on a court action. The establishing of high service standards. Another one from the back, Presiding Officer.
Bob Doris.
I apologise, Minister. I'll try very hard to be brief. I previously corresponded to you with you on this matter. A lot of constituents still feel that social landlords have to do better in consulting in relation to rent increases. In fact, social landlords have to have regard for the views of tenants, but there's no set process for what consultation should look like, and some believe there has to be greater constraint in rent levels in the social rented sector. Will the Minister give consideration to how any legislation in this place can take better account of that?
Minister, I can give you some of that time back.
I'm grateful. I think these are very fair points, and I hope that those kind of arguments will come across in consultation responses. Tenants' voice is critical. If we're going to shift some of the power imbalances and address some of the injustices that exist, that can be, in many places, better organised at the moment within the social rented sector, but there is still scope to do that better, to learn from the best practice, and I hope that people will take this consultation as an opportunity to put forward constructive ideas for how to achieve that. I'm returning to private rented tenancies. I am seeking views on the existing tenancies and the grounds for repossession. I'm exploring how tenants can feel more at home in their rented property. Simple things like being able to decorate or keep pets. They might be seen as trivial by some people, but they're really critical to people feeling that a house is a home and supporting their well-being and mental health. I am proposing new restrictions on evictions in winter, and there are a number of questions about defining how that's going to work that we want to hear views on, as well as ensuring that the penalties for illegal evictions in the private sector are a meaningful deterrent. I'm highlighting the need to help people living in non-traditional rented accommodation, from student accommodation to residential mobile homes, and from the Gypsy Traveller community to people in agricultural tenancies. Now, it's right to raise standards, but just as important to ensure that renting is affordable. People who rent privately, on average, spend more of their income, over a quarter, on that rent. And for some, it's much more than that. The social rented sector already has some safeguards in place to protect tenants from high rent rises, and all the money from rents should be reinvested for the good of tenants. That is, to say the least, inconsistent in the private rented sector, where approaches to rent setting can vary dramatically between different landlords. So we're consulting on how to introduce an effective national system of rent controls by 2025 for privately rented homes, with appropriate mechanisms to allow local authorities to introduce local measures. Now, I recognise that campaigners for this policy are impatient, and I've even seen some people argue that we should be using coronavirus emergency legislation to bypass the need to consult. I don't agree with that. The Scottish Parliament has always consulted before legislating where we can, where that's possible, and that's as it should be. It helps us to make better law. The weakness of the 2016 reform to create rent pressure zones is a warning of legislation that's developed swiftly without adequate testing or dialogue. I want the new system to be one that works for the long term, and that means collecting the information we need, learning from what works well elsewhere, and taking the time to get this right. So we will improve on the data collection in the private rented sector around rents and other factors so that we have the evidence needed to inform an effective system. A more detailed consultation on rent control will follow later in the Parliament as that evidence base gathers and picks up pace. And at the same time, we'll be looking at how best to share good practice and improve affordability in the social rented sector as well. Of course, affordability and supply are closely linked, and I know that Parliament will support my commitment to our expanded programme of 110,000 affordable homes, 70% of them for social rent, by 2032. This is a programme on a larger scale than any for decades, and I'm determined to work with colleagues across government and across Parliament to ensure that every contribution counts, public, private, community and third sector, to achieve that goal. New homes for rent are rightly a major theme in this New Deal for tenants, but most of the homes that we will live in 2040 are already here today, and that's why we're seeking views on how we can improve quality and raise standards across the whole rented sector, both in terms of physical buildings and the services provided to all tenants. With this in mind, I'm seeking views on establishing a new housing standard for all homes. Presiding officer, I could say more. There's a great deal to do and a great deal of work ahead of us throughout this session of Parliament. There will be no shortage of views, and the consultation is open for the next 16 weeks so that everyone can engage on the wide-ranging and ambitious aims of this agenda. In summary, I believe this draft strategy will deliver a new deal for tenants, with stronger rights, greater protections against evictions, and access to better, more affordable homes. That will help us to deliver a fairer Scotland, tackle child poverty, and meet our climate change targets. So I urge MSPs from across the chamber to support that ambition, contribute their ideas, and join me in welcoming this new deal for tenants. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Miles Briggs to speak to Move Amendment 2625.1 for around 7 minutes, Mr. Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking the organisations which have provided useful briefings ahead of today's debate, and thank the many housing charities and organisations across the country who work in all our communities. The Scottish Government's draft rented sector strategy proposes a number of new rights and protections for Scottish tenants, many of which we support on these benches and want to see improved, specifically around the issue of domestic abuse and the rights of victims. I believe there is an opportunity to significantly improve and help to make sure that support is available, and I hope genuinely the Minister will look at making this strategy an opportunity for all of us across this Parliament to contribute and to help achieve that. However, from the outset, I would express concern at some of the more controversial proposals which have been outlined in the strategy. What the rented sector in Scotland needs is proper investment and further action to stop increased rents. instead of missed house building targets and cuts to the housing budget, which we've seen put forward at stage one of the Scottish Government budget. As Shelter Scotland make clear in their briefing for today's debate, without increasing the supply of social homes, realising the commitment to deliver the right to adequate housing will be extremely difficult. In the short time I have today, I wanted to concentrate on a few areas outlined in my amendment for today's debate. The strategy details plans to establish an independent regulator for the private rented sector to operate in a similar vein to that of the Scottish Housing Regulator, which currently covers social rents, and a national system of rent controls. Now, the Minister has already outlined that further consultation on rent controls will be proposed later in this Parliament. But it is clear from countries where rent controls are currently in operation that the supply of rental properties has been negatively impacted, and indeed the policy outcomes around controlling levels of rent have not been achieved. Now, I'd be interested to know, when the Minister is closing the debate, what assessment has already taken place, genuine assessment by Ministers, of this proposal for a national rent control included in the strategy, and how that discussion shaping the consultation he's outlined will actually now take place, because I think it's important, if we're going to have that debate, that we start to look at the unintended consequences and international lessons we already are aware of. As it's becoming a hallmark of this government that unintended consequences around regulations and legislation are not properly looked at, and there are concerns at the negative impact that will have, potentially on tenants, but also on landlords. Now, the strategy admits to outline what impact existing legislation, such as rent pressure zones, has actually had on existing high rental markets, for example, here in the capital. And I'd also like to see what understanding and what important aspects of this will be considered in the strategy. I'm happy to, if I could get some time back.
Minister.
Thank Miles Briggs for giving way. It's very clear that rent pressure zones have not been used anywhere by any local authority. And I think one of the issues there is that the burden of responsibility is on them to come forward with the evidence. So I do hope that even if the Conservatives don't support the proposals on rent controls, ultimately they will support the action we need to gather the evidence and the data that's required to design a good system.
I very much agree with that point. And on the, you know, rent pressure zones, which were brought forward by the government, local authorities haven't felt that they provide them with the powers they need, or actually the opportunity to make any difference. So I think it is something we need to look at. But certainly in terms of the answer to the question of rent pressure zones doesn't seem to be forthcoming. I think one of the key things is just market levels of rent, for example, here in the capital, which are much higher than other parts of the country. So it is important, above all, that we look towards the deliverability of affordable housing. In their evidence to the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee, the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations made clear their concerns around ongoing rises in construction costs. But that spike in construction costs is having an impact both on maintenance and future developments. The Association were clear that without additional support from Scottish Ministers, the long-term solutions to these issues will be difficult to develop, and the impact on housing association budgets and abilities to keep rents affordable is obviously an issue they're concerned about as well. In the programme for government, SNP ministers set out a house building target over 11 years into the future, 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, with at least 70% in the social rented sector and 10% in remote, rural and island communities. Now, we have to look at the government's record to date. And since 2016, the SNP promised to build 50,000 affordable homes. Ministers have failed to meet that target. Up to March 2021, only 28,154 houses were actually completed in the social rent sector. And in rural Scotland, that situation is even more concerning. SNP ministers spent less than half of the £25 million budget allocated to rural housing funds, just £11.4 million of that fund delivering just 59 affordable homes in rural Scotland over that four-year period. So the rhetoric is strong from ministers, but the delivering on these promises has not been forthcoming. Now, Scottish Conservatives want to see SNP Green ministers step up the affordable home building agenda across the country. That's the only way we can properly address the fundamental issue faced by tenants today and the lack of affordable housing which we see across our communities. Finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, I wanted to touch upon what is a key part of my amendment for today, and that is for us to look towards the strategy to also look at homeless people and the lack of action around temporary accommodation, which we've seen from the government. SNP Green ministers will know that the number of families and children in unsuitable and temporary accommodation is now at a record high, with rental costs increasing. So one of the main barriers preventing many people securing a home and a secure tenancy needs to be considered as well. So I hope, as this strategy is developed, that ministers will genuinely look at these issues as well and these concerns, because we need to make sure that the solutions which are being developed around the lack of affordable housing and the issues which many councils are currently facing around unsuitable accommodation orders are not forgotten about and will be included as we move forward. So to conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, it's vital that SNP Green ministers listen to these real concerns which are being put forward at this stage of their strategy being proposed. I hope we will see far more engagement from ministers across the Parliament, something which I don't believe we've seen today on this strategy. Many of us coming to this debate have issues we want to see included in the strategy and future legislation, and I hope the Minister will make sure that that's included. And I finally move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Briggs. I can advise the Chamber that we are tight for time. That's not an instruction not to take interventions, but you may need to accommodate them in your time allocation. With that, I call Mark Griffin to speak to and move Amendment 2625.2 for 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I draw members' attention to my register of interest as an owner of a rented property in North Lanarkshire. Scottish Labour welcomes the publication of the draft rented sector strategy consultation, finally arriving by the end of the year, because we have long called for more meaningful government intervention in the private rented sector, improving tenants' rights and protecting people from rising rents, just as my colleague Polly McNeill's Fair Rents Bill and our general work and campaigning in the last session would have done. Now, once again, with more restrictions expected soon on top of the reinstatement of widespread self-isolation rules, the pandemic forces us to acknowledge that our homes have never meant so much to us. If we have somewhere that we can call home, if it's warm and safe, once again, it's the first line of defence from COVID. We'll support the motion today and agree with the aims of the strategy. Tenants must have secure and stable tenancies, rights to truly live in them, a pause clause and a chance to decorate, continued safeguards against eviction and private sector rent controls. But we also want to use this debate to ask the government to tackle and to take immediate action, because COVID continues to exacerbate the housing crisis. And, Presiding Officer, how quickly we move is key. Last month, the First Minister told me the government was happy to engage about the timing of legislation on rent controls. So our amendment this afternoon singularly seeks to hold the government to that and secure agreement that the framework for those rent controls must be put in legislation sooner rather than later via the forthcoming housing bill. Yeah, certainly.
Minister.
I'm grateful, and I would like to be able to support the Labour amendment if I understand its meaning correctly. When Mr Griffin says that the framework needs to be brought forward in the Year 2 Bill, is he referring, as I hope he is, to the need to generate the data that's required to understand and to design a proper system? We're not going to be able to implement the rent control system fully in that Year 2 Bill, but we will put the framework in place for the collection of data. If that's what he means, then I very much welcome his position and would like to support his amendment.
Mr Griffin.
Yep, certainly not expecting the legislation to come into force in Year 2 of this Parliament, but the framework for the rules, for the data, for the system that we, the broad system that we expect to see implemented, the details around that, would certainly look to see that in the housing bill coming forward. But let's not forget that the controls are urgent. The number of children in private rented housing who live in severe poverty more than doubled in the last decade from 2008. Now, Living Rent, I've said that they're ready to go on this too. Their proposed points-based system linking rents to the quality of property aligns with the strategy's vision, I think. And that link to equality provides an incentive for landlords to make the improvements, but also a block on those landlords who refuse to do so. And importantly, it attaches the control of the control to the property, not to the lease. Now, this landmark reform would deal with the fundamentals of costly rents, taking a step forward, taking a step of progress forward towards the human right of an adequate home for all. But 2023 is still a lifetime away for renters struggling. Now, the situation for those tenants is reaching crisis point, and as Live and Rent say, they can't wait another 5 or so years for those protections. A major cost of living crisis is just weeks away. Energy bills set to rocket by 40% in April, and last month the government's own statistics showed inflation busting rent increases in Western Bartonshire, Ayrshire, Fife, Forth Valley and Lanarkshire in 2020. The contribution of rents to November's unprecedented 5% inflation figure was the highest since March 2016. So that starting point that we're at is bleak, and almost 150,000 people are waiting for a social or a council house. Homelessness applications are up, and after a University of Glasgow report estimating that £126 million is owed in the private sector, social arrears jumped £9 million over the summer. It looks like an estimate is that arrears in the rented sector have topped £300 million. Now, changes to the notice period and pre-action protocols for evictions have proved to keep people in their homes, so they should stay, and I look forward to working with the government on that commitment. But going into the new year, I echo the call of Living Rent and Shelter for those reforms to be made permanent. Doing so would prevent an eviction crisis in the short term, but the government must also consider extending the eviction ban, given the fast-developing situation with Omicron. Presiding Officer, the importance of stability and security for renters is not secondary to affordability. It's fundamental to a sense of self and to make choices. And security stems from the ability to call a place a home, as the Minister points out. People without open space, without a spare room and the freedom to have a pet or redecorate, regardless of tenure, endured a miserable pandemic. And those who did, mostly occupiers, could work from home, do renovations and consider upsizing. Research from Crisis also found over 40% of employers were unprepared to support a homeless employee and would even consider terminating their employment, and that's a devastating statistic, and it reinforces the call that Pam Duncan Glancy made for a winter eviction ban to be in place right now. But, Presiding Officer, I'll conclude simply by supporting the strategy as outlined by the Minister and look forward to working with the Government on that and move the amendment in my name.
Thanks very much indeed, Mr Griffin. I now call on Willie Rennie to speak to move amendment 2625.3 for 4 minutes, please, Mr Rennie.
I've been in too many shoddy, damp, mouldy, poorly insulated, cold yet far too expensive properties that could ever be classed as a place called home. A building that makes you ill is no place to live. It should be a human right to have a warm, affordable home, and I'm sure everyone on all sides of the chamber today would agree with that objective. The question is, how do we get there, and how do we get there quickly? Because this crisis has gone on for far too long. All housing organisations speak with unity today when they point to the need for an increased supply of affordable housing. We simply don't have enough affordable or social homes, and we need to build far, far more. At the election, we offered a commitment to 40,000 homes for social rent in the next 5 years. And that was an important part of our plan to build more homes that people can afford, with an initial programme of 60,000. We want to return to a housing market that re-establishes social renting as a valid long-term option for people. But there is concern from Shelter today that the Scottish Government's commitment for 110,000 over the next decade has been downgraded to an ambition So it would be helpful to have clarity from the Minister whether it is only an ambition rather than an election promise and a commitment. My amendment today is aimed at strengthening the Government's motion so that we can have confidence that the housing supply is a top priority for the Government. I'm interested in what works. I'm less interested in slogans. We are interested in rent controls, but we are cautious about how effective those rent controls will be. We want to support the motion today, the consultation launched last week, and the future consultation that the Minister has set out on rent controls in the future. We need to work on the detail. We think that is incredibly important, because there are, despite what I said about an awful lot of poorly rented and poor quality homes, the private rented sector does provide a lot of good homes for good tenants with good landlords. So we've got a duty to get this right, to make sure that any rent controls in the future create the right incentives for the sector. So that's why I want to make sure we get this right. We've seen from evidence from other countries that have rent controls that the benefits are often not clear-cut. It seems to have an effect on the investment in the sector. It also has an effect on the type of properties that the private rented sector will invest in, but also potentially have an effect that the control rent or the cap becomes the minimum rise as well as the maximum increase. We want to see the detailed proposals and the evidence to back up those proposals, so we are open to see what works. It is important, as I say, that we ensure that we have a high-quality private rented sector, and that's why we need to treat this with care. We won't be supporting the Conservative amendment this afternoon because it rules out the rent controls. We think it's important to explore it and explore it with the evidence. But we will be supporting, from the basis of what Mark Griffin has said earlier on with the Labour amendment, that it does actually allow further evidence to be gathered. So we will be supporting. It is important that we invest in the housing sector in Scotland. Far too many homes are shoddy. Far too many are poorly insulated. And that's why this paper and the Housing to 2040 paper is incredibly important. We need to get this right. Too many homes are at stake. Thank you.
Could you perhaps move your amendment, please, yep. Mr Rennie?
I move the amendment in my name.
Much obliged. Thank you. We now move to the open debate. First speaker will be Audrey Nicholl, to be followed by Finlay Carson. 4 minutes, please, Ms Nicholl.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I draw members' attention to my register of interest. I'm a councillor in Aberdeen City Council. A new deal for tenants is a crucial consultation to address long-standing issues in the rented housing sector, specifically security, affordability, standards and regulation. We all deserve a warm, dry and affordable home to live in, where we feel secure and safe. Access to housing is a recognised social determinant of health, sitting alongside education, health services, employment and economic stability as key factors in ensuring good health and well-being. There's no doubt the pandemic has heightened anxiety and insecurity for many living in Scotland's rental sector. Many lost their jobs or became too unwell to work, and despite Lifeline's Scottish Government's support for tenants at risk of arrears and eviction, rising costs, cuts to universal credit, Brexit have created a perfect storm for many tenants across Scotland. I therefore welcome the SNP Scottish Greens agreement that puts the rights of tenants and the right to housing at its heart. Like other North East constituencies, over recent decades, Aberdeen South and North Kincardine saw sustained high rents courtesy of the energy sector. Yet the reality is that we continue to host poor quality rented stock, particularly in Aberdeen City. Typically dated council housing stock, now impacted by damp and mould, has largely gone unactioned. 59% of homes in Aberdeen are not energy efficient, resulting in high fuel bills, high carbon emissions, and residents unable to heat their homes to a comfortable level. Indeed, I currently have a local consultation underway with residents living in some of the poorest quality housing in my constituency to identify the housing issues most impacting on them, and responses to date have been stark. The local economy, once propped up by oil and gas, has been in decline, and this is reflected in the private rental sector, where between 2010 and 2014, rents consistently rose far above the Scottish average, only to decline rapidly since. This means today rents are largely the same as they were a decade ago. Some private housing developments that had commenced before then have now become unprofitable or even collapsed, impacting the supply of badly needed social housing, but also the delivery of developer obligations such as schools. We face the bizarre paradox where there is now an overprovision of private rented properties, yet in June 2020, the waiting list for council houses was over 6,000. Regrettably, Aberdeen City Council's commitment to build 2,000 new homes has fallen short, with only 900 completed to date, adding to an already significant shortage of affordable housing in the city. Presiding Officer, safe to say local change is needed, starting with genuine commitment to build more high-standard affordable homes and, where feasible, retrofitting existing homes to make them warm, dry and more livable. I welcome our commitment to build 110,000 affordable homes over the coming decade, but within that, I want to see local projects driven by what is required in housing areas and not what developers choose to include in a project specification, in other words, the tail wagging the dog. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, the New Deal for Tenants consultation is a very welcome step from Housing to 2040, and it offers a tangible opportunity for tenants to have their voice and for us to provide our constituents with good quality, secure and safe rental housing provision that they deserve. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicholl. And I call on Finlay Carson to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Type 4 minutes, please, Mr Carson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It goes without saying that the housing system in Scotland is notoriously complex, and I welcome the opportunity to make positive changes to our rental sector to address the fundamental underlying problems that tenants and landlords face. It gives us the chance to address a number of issues like, for instance, amending the Scottish Model Tenancy Agreement for private residential tenancies so consent for a pet is the default position for responsible pet owners. Landlords should only be able to refuse pets with good reason, putting an end to the blanket no pets policy, and that would bring it in line with recent amendments made on the English Model Tenancy Agreement. And we also need more social housing providers to introduce reasonable pet policies to allow responsible tenants in social housing to keep pets in suitable properties, allowing responsible tenants to keep pets. So now, if you are not a cat or a dog lover, this may not seem like a major problem, but cats and dogs bring their renting owners joy, love and companionship. And a cat protection survey found that 92% of social tenants and 73% of private tenants in Scotland are able to keep their own cats report that they had a positive effect on their life, such as making them happier, providing company and affection, and improving mental health. And if that's the case, the chances of those tenants leaving are far less. And I recently had the pleasure of meeting with the animal charity Cats Protection, and its most recent report, which is very cleverly named Cats Report, Cats and Their Stats. They found that renting with a cat in Scotland can be quite difficult. Pet-friendly rental houses are in short supply, with just 10% of private landlords explicitly allowing cats and only a further 25% permitting a pet, but not specifying an actual pet. It's estimated that 1 million UK households who would like to own a cat cannot because they live in rented accommodation that doesn't allow pets. And that's a staggering 1.6 million more cats in the UK that could be rehomed if landlords allowed pets. And whilst I absolutely understand that landlords may be reluctant to rent to cat or dog owners for the fear their pet might damage the property, this is not the case. For example, the charity showed that 83% of cat-friendly private landlords actually reported having no problems at all. But there is absolutely need to be a recognition that in some cases landlords are left with a far bigger cost than they would otherwise have if they needed to replace carpets and so on, and when re-renting, re-letting their properties. And often the deposit doesn't cover the cost, so that does need to be considered, because there's obligations and responsibilities on both sides, as always is the case with landlords and tenant relationships. But with that regards, the Dog Trust and Cat Protection have created a pet CV to help potential tenants with dogs and cats to highlight that the responsible pet owners, so landlords and letting agents can be better informed. And the pet CV sets out details about the animal, including if they're neutered, microchipped, vaccinated, and information about their general behaviour and temperament. So that could be a vital tool in helping landlords assess if a tenant is a responsible pet owner. But it's not just animal lovers who are facing issues when it comes to private and social housing. More needs to be done to improve accountability, affordability and the quality of existing housing. And the Federation of Housing Associations rightly points out social housing is one of the main reasons are the main rights, and one of the main rights is to a safe, warm, affordable home in a thriving community. And Shelter Scotland insists that enough social houses are built to reduce affordable housing needs. Additional rights for tenants are welcome, but the SNP strategy fails to address the fundamental issues of shortages within Scottish housing and rental markets. And I'm sure members across the chamber will agree with me that spiralling rents are often caused by housing shortages, and that's the real issue facing today's renters. Tenants are still faced with rising costs caused by a national housing shortage, particularly in rural areas, a situation which will not be helped with a reduction in the Scottish housing budget in the financial year 2022-23. Deputy Presiding Officer, we must see an increase in investment in rural areas like Dumfries and Galloway, where many young people are forced to leave communities because of a shortage of suitable housing.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Carson. The next two speakers join us remotely. Firstly, Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Polly McNeill. Ms Dunbar, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I draw members' attention to my register of interest. I'm still a serving councillor at Aberdeen City Council. Presiding Officer, I'm grateful to have the opportunity to speak in this important debate today regarding the Scottish Government's plans to strengthen the rights of tenants across Scotland. In this day and age, everyone should have the right to a safe, secure, affordable home which meets their needs. Throughout the COVID-19 pandemic, we've seen the importance of having a suitable home, with increased protections for renters being required to prevent evictions and ensure secure, safe housing for all during the difficult lockdowns. The Scottish Government delivered £10 million to local authorities to provide grants to tenants who have fallen behind in their rent as a result of the pandemic and who were at risk of eviction. Forming part of the package of measures local authorities could use to tackle homelessness, which included discretionary housing payments and additional advice on maximising incomes. Presiding Officer, nearly 40% of people in Scotland rent their homes, so it's absolutely key that we get this right. It should not matter if you're renting from the local authority, a registered social landlord, or indeed the private sector. Everyone should be entitled to good, quality housing that they can call their home. On that point, the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic has offered us all an opportunity to reflect on what is important to us when it comes to our housing needs. Over the past 2 years, we've seen a very unique set of circumstances that nobody could have envisioned. Many people have been required to work from home, and that brings with it its own challenges. We've all spent more time at home than we perhaps would have liked or planned for, and for many renters, outdoor space is extremely limited. But this has highlighted the need for high quality, suitable housing for everyone in our country, not just those who can afford the most expensive rents. Housing should be a human right. It should not be dictated by anyone's ability to pay. The COVID-19 pandemic has given us an opportunity to re-evaluate priorities when it comes to rented properties and has highlighted the need for protections for both renters and landlords. Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to see the Scottish Government bring forward this consultation to seek views on a proposal for a fairer rented sector. Increasing penalties for illegal evictions, restricting evictions during winter, and giving tenants flexibility to personalise their homes and keep pets the list goes on. I'm also pleased to see included in the proposals the requirement for a minimum standard for energy efficiency, helping Scotland to reach our net zero goals and helping to ensure that no renter should have to make the decision between heating and eating. Presiding Officer, renters make up nearly half of our population, and within the public sector housing, there is an expectation that renters have the right to safe, secure housing that meets their needs. And this legislation seeks to level the playing field between public and private tenants and ensure they are all afforded the same security. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Polly McNeill, who also is joining us remotely, to be followed by Paul McLennan. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I believe the Scottish Government missed the opportunity in the last Parliament to get private sector rents under control. And I say this because I felt a sense of frustration that my fair rents bill was not supported by the governing party. I believe we lost some critical time in tackling poverty and inequality. But I want to make clear that I plan to work with the Scottish Government and with Patrick Harvey, who I know is committed to doing this, set of reforms. And I hope that the Minister will consider incorporating some of the ideas in my fair rents bill and forthcoming legislation. Tenants cannot wait till 2025 to see at least some change. There is the need for parity in the private rented sector with the public sector, and it's long overdue. It has been an extremely tough year with tens of thousands of people losing their jobs and their incomes. And for many in the private rented sector, they've also had to contend with rents rising above the rate of inflation yet again. It will be worse, but you see the Scottish Government figures on private rents up to the end of September 2021 showing average rent increases in low days in Greater Glasgow, again increasing above the rate of inflation. And between the years 2010 and 2021, you will see rent rises well above the rate of inflation on all property sizes. But do not believe it's simply a Glasgow and Edinburgh problem. Statistics will show that in West Dunbartonshire, for example, staggering increases of 71.1% and in Ayrshire, 6.8%. So I'm pleased that the temporary legislation that we passed during this COVID legislation in the Parliament has clearly succeeded in preventing mass evictions during the worst of the pandemic. But it has also sheltered public services from the additional pressures of responding to ensure a reduction in homelessness. A report by Andrew Watson of Glasgow University published last month found that around 1 in 5 landlords had current tenancies in arrears at July 2021 this year. And that scales up to around 45,000 landlords across Scotland with arrears that Mark Griffin mentioned of around 126 million. It is a real crisis. It is a crisis we need to get our heads around. But the state of the private rented sector leaves much to be desired. Many tenants routinely suffer from water penetration, damp and condensation, and associated mold growth. These problems are made frequently worse by repairs which are often slow, and issues ongoing mean that they often go unrepaired and unresolved. So I believe that rent controls must be linked to the quality of the accommodation that people rent. And my fair rents bill would have done this. There is a clear link between poverty and high housing costs. And this should be the centrepiece of the legislation, I believe. We cannot continue to accept the number of people who are living in poverty in this sector, many of whom have no alternative available to them. And this is the key point, because evidence shows that 30% of tenants spend their income, 30% of their income, and some spend 40 and 50% of their income. A mortgage is cheaper for most of these people, but by the very problem, they will not get access to alternative options for housing. Young people are at the centre of this housing issue. They need a fair deal. We need a fair deal for families. We need to recognise that single parents are very likely to be struggling in this sector to pay their rent, as we've seen that the number of children living in the private rented sector in severe poverty has more than doubled. I want to conclude, Presiding Officer, by saying that we need a fair deal for students too. There is a way to address Willie Rennie's point, which is contained within my bill. I'd be happy to talk another day about this. We can overcome the problems. Students in the private rented sector saw their rents in the last 3 years rise by 34%, and many of them in private accommodation have no rights. I ask the Minister to consider in this reform that students will also be at the centre of housing reform, that we do it in this Parliament, and that we make sure we make a difference by tackling poverty and giving people a real option for a good, affordable, warm home. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thanks for the opportunity to speak in this debate. I welcome the consultation with all the relevant parties. Can I refer to my register of interests? I'm a serving councillor in East Lothian. I also in a rental property in East Lothian. I grew up on a council estate in Dunbar with my mum, my dad and my sister. It was and still is a close-knit community. I've also been a councillor for 15 years in Dunbar, and the most pressing issue in that time, and any councillor will tell you this, are housing-related issues. I think people have mentioned about the various houses they've been in. I've been in various houses with various states and various sectors, so it's a much-needed consultation. In East Lothian, the Right to Buy scheme seen us lose 8,000 council houses with no means to replace these. Today and every day, we are still trying to recover from this. So how we treat our tenants is key and fundamental to ensure a vibrant housing sector. As the motion highlights, there are 1.85 million people who live in the rented sector. That's 37% of all housing in Scotland. They should have improved quality, standards and rights in the place they call home. They should have the right to more secure and stable tenancies with improved safeguards against eviction, improved regulation and effective national rent controls in the private sector that the Minister also mentioned. Shelter Scotland said this is an ambitious strategy. It offers a chance to mend many new aspects of a housing system that is currently failing thousands. The Scottish Federation of Housing Associations said, we welcome the Scottish Government's ambition that all tenants should have access to secure, good quality, affordable homes. In the short time I have, I want to focus on two main issues in the consultation. Firstly is the commitment to deliver 110,000 homes. We need to ensure we have an appropriate tenure mix, ensuring deliverability and looking at other funding models to support the long-term commitment. As we've heard, the target is for at least 70% for social rent and 10% that Finlay Carson mentioned in our remote, rural and island communities. That happens in East Lothian. I think the remote and rural issue is a really, really important one. And I'll come on to that in a little bit second, but how I think we can maybe look to deliver that. We also need to ensure that the private sector can deliver its commitment, with much of affordable housing targets dependent on this. This has, of course, been supported by £3.6 billion of Scottish Government investment. Housing supply affects affordability and quality across all tenures, but we also need that supply to have the proper tenure mix, so everyone has the right to housing that they need at a price that they can afford. Local authority local development plans have a key part in this as well, as they deliver affordable rented accommodation. They need to be brave in their allocations. Mid-market rent has a role to play, along with built rent, which is a growing sector with Scotland, and they all have a key role in ensuring that tenure balance that I talked about before. I'm also keen for us to explore other funding models. In my constituency, I've seen housing delivered with funding from co-op pension funds and LAR Housing Trust through commercial lending. We need to look at ways of scaling up these delivery options to maximise grant funding. Both have worked with the Council on regarding allocations, and I think that's really, really important. The second issue is about strengthening and enforcing housing rights. I welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to deliver a new human right to adequate housing through the forthcoming Human Rights Bill. Shelter Scotland stated in this is welcome and is a vital step on the journey to ensuring everyone has access to a home that meets their needs. Accompanied with ensuring this is an adequate supply of social housing in places that need it most, this will help to tackle Scotland's housing emergency. We welcome the rented sector strategy focus on marginalised groups and look forward to more work being done in this area to fix the broken and biased housing system, which disproportionately harms people with disabilities, women and people from ethnic minority backgrounds. And just on that issue, only a few weeks ago I met with East and Middle Lothian's Women Aid. They identified housing policies for those fleeing domestic abuse required a different approach through a gender competent approach. We need to ensure that changes are made for the sake of that alone. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I look forward to working with all sectors in Scotland's housing sector to deliver that basic human right of a house over the head that they can call home. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Ariane Burgess, who's joining us remotely, to be followed by Emma Roddick, who will also join us remotely. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Burgess.
Thank you, Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights for proposing this motion, which signals the beginning of a long overdue transformation in Scotland's private rented sector. For too long, tenants have been second-class citizens living in houses that they cannot make their homes. Housing is a fundamental human right, and I know that members across this chamber will agree that everyone deserves to live in a secure, affordable and good quality home. Draft New Deal for Tenants will deliver on that right, and I'm proud to support this motion on behalf of the Scottish Green Party. Reforming the private rented sector is hard graft, and that is why Green ministers in government, with the grit and determination to tackle difficult problems, are so vital for the long-term well-being of tenants. During the pandemic, we spent more time indoors than ever. Our surroundings and sense of belonging are essential to good mental health. The seemingly simple things like allowing tenants to decorate their homes and keep pets can uplift mood and alleviate loneliness. Poor conditions have been far too common in the private rented sector, and we've seen some rents skyrocket even during the pandemic. Last winter, we saw evictions banned. It's time that is the case every winter, not just during a pandemic, and firm action will be taken against landlords who evict illegally, whatever time of year. Greens in government will deliver protections and controls to ensure that tenants are not subject to unfair treatment, with much needed rent controls and action for unfair evictions. Tenants across the country who don't have the time, money or energy to fight their corner will now have a greater say in the private renter sector, with new tenants participation panel and options to establish tenants unions. They will be supported to do this with new powers to allocate long-term unclaimed deposits to fund rights and representation work. But landlords too will benefit in turn from tenants who are invested in the properties they live in and connected to the communities surrounding them. Presiding Officer, Scotland is a founding member of the Wellbeing Economy Governments Group, and the New Deal for Tenants is exactly the kind of innovative approach that which will put our well-being of the people of Scotland in the Scottish Government's housing policy. These changes will not just be felt in urban areas. Rural and island communities will see action taken on residential mobile homes, agriculture and tied tenancies. Rent controls in these areas will also tackle the rural depopulation crisis by making housing more affordable and preventing young people being priced out of the communities they grew up in. I'm hopeful that with new rent guarantee tour scheme for estranged young people, we will help some of the most vulnerable young people live authentically and break free of abuse. With the good review of grounds to end private tenancies and actions to make it easier to exit a joint tenancy, we will make sure that tenancies are fit for purpose and can adapt more easily to changes in life circumstances. Presiding Officer, this deal for tenants may be new to us, but it simply brings us in line with many fellow European countries who have long protected tenants with measures such as rent controls. Back in August, as part of the shared policy programme, the Greens said we would introduce a new deal for tenants. 4 months later, we are delivering. Green MSPs as Green ministers delivering on Green promises. The Scottish Government, the Scottish Greens will stand with tenants and tenants unions to revolutionise the private rented housing sector, which will deliver for people, not profit, with view houses as homes and place well-being at the heart of our housing policy.
Thank you. I now call Emma Roddick to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I celebrated the strides made last session in terms of making private tenancies more secure. While it didn't undo the fact that I'd been priced out of my studio flat in Inverness after the landlord hiked the price despite there being no hot water for a year, or that I'd been kicked out of another because the owner wanted to stick it on Airbnb, I knew that it would be harder for landlords to pull that in future. And I'm as delighted as anyone else who's put off getting a pet or snuck their cat into the back of a pal's car every time the landlord came round that we are here discussing the right to make your home your own. Affordability is now the big issue that we have to tackle for private tenants. Commitments to build social and affordable houses across Scotland will do wonders in attempt to claw back some of the balance in the housing market. But as fantastic as 110,000 new homes will be, it isn't enough. And we all know it's not enough, because the constant loss of homes to absentee landlords in tourist hotspots, and the fact that so many people are waiting on housing lists that you have to be homeless to get a council house half the time, can't be addressed by house building alone. And in terms of depopulation, a house expected in 2035 won't stop people leaving the Highlands tomorrow. Now, I understand that the measures we're talking about take time to implement. However, we have to recognise that a five-year warning to landlords that they won't be able to increase rents will mean many hiking their prices now. And I do urge the Minister to do what he can to tackle that mindset. I've said this in the Chamber before, and I will keep saying it. We cannot make policy that relies on the goodwill of landlords. We have to make policy which puts the right of tenants, people who are using houses as homes, far above the rights of landlords to own multiple properties with little regulation and a guaranteed increase in their value. Miles Briggs called these proposals controversial and asked for bailouts for landlords instead. Now, I would suggest that if you cannot meet your obligations as a landlord, you should not be a landlord. Presiding Officer, these proposals are not extreme, they are just not conservative. And until Scotland starts to vote conservative, my colleagues on those benches should probably get used to the fact that the government is not. In a number of communities I represent, over-tourism has prompted the conversion of, in some cases, over 50% of locally available residential properties to holiday homes with key safes at the door, which lie empty, cannot house our badly needed health and social care workers, students or families, and drive up the cost of both homes themselves and the ever scarcer long-term rents available nearby. And whatever figures you want to use to argue how much money this brings to local pubs and shops, those places won't stay open without staff, and those staff need homes. Whatever you say about how much we need tourism, we need communities more. I had 8 addresses in the space of 3 years before I found this flat. Now, that insecurity prevents you from embedding into your community. And I know stories of people living rurally in COVID who realised they suddenly had no neighbours to help with the messages because all nearby houses were empty holiday lets. In 2019, the Scottish Government reported over 22,000 whole home Airbnb listings. That's a whole fifth of our 14-year house building programme. Only 4 hosts were responsible for nearly 2,500 listings, and we know that that issue is only getting worse. Rent controls may well make unregulated short-term letting at higher prices for shorter stays even more attractive. So while much of what I'm hearing is so positive, I urge the Scottish Government to work across portfolios on this. We need to tackle the housing crisis from all angles if we are going to make a difference.
Thank you. I now call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Rona Mackay. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There can be no doubt, as others have said, that Scotland is facing a difficult period in regard to the housing market. Here in the Lothians, it can be seen starkly as rents rise and available properties fall. Something has to be done to address these problems, and I want to place on record my willingness and my party's willingness to work with anyone in this chamber on a reasonable measures. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, we must be careful about what constitutes a reasonable measure. We cannot allow ourselves to fall into the trap of thinking about doing something is the same as helping. We must not allow ourselves to be seduced by the easy option of measures that will help in the short term but will wreak untold damage in the future. It is incumbent upon the members of this Parliament not to be short-sighted, to see beyond our dogmatic convictions and consider the consequences of legislation beyond this 5-year parliamentary term. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Government's so-called New Deal for tenants is not the revolutionary legislation that we would have the country believe. It is a package of old, tired and previously unsuccessful policies that define the concept of a short-term fix at the expense of future generations. Deputy Presiding Officer, my colleagues in the Green Party like to talk about the settled science. Well, I'm afraid when it comes to rent controls, the verdict is in and they do not work. Mr Rennie asked for evidence about why we go down this road in a second. It's not as if we do not have examples after examples from across the world of instances when we have seen implemented and have failed to fix the problem in regard to affordability.
Minister.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. There are a number of countries, of course, including some in Europe, that have a system of rent controls and are not seeking to abolish it, are not saying that there are huge unintended consequences. But what about the consequence of not acting? Mr Balfour and I both represent cities that have been seeing wildly disproportionate, way above inflation rent increases. Do we simply not act and allow that to happen?
Jeremy Balfour.
I thank the Minister for his comment. I think the Minister would reckon that the countries he's talking about in Europe have a very different housing market to ours here in Scotland. And I think the biggest issue that we face is if we go for rent control, then landlords will own maybe one flat or two flats, will simply sell them, take them off the market, and those who are looking to rent will have less choice rather than more choice. And that economically means rent will go up. Of course, there will be short-term benefits for renters if these proposals go through. However, these are minimal and dwarfed by the cost of future renters. Now, I would argue none of this is controversial. An economist from the left-leaning Brookings Institute in America stated this: rent controls appears to help affordability in the short run for current tenants. But in the long run, they decrease affordability, they make negative extremes, and they affect surrounding neighbourhoods in a way that no one would expect. I would suggest that if we go down rent controls, that is what will happen in this country. Yes, we need to fix the problem that has been created over the last 14 years. Scotland would be better served by the Scottish Government if it focused on meeting their targets on new houses built, a measure that would effectively bring prices down and would make sure that there's enough accommodation for everybody to have, rather than trying to fix the market. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Rona Mackay to be followed by Mercedes Villalba. Rona Mackay will be joining us remotely. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Some of the most distressing cases my office deals with are from tenants who are being forced to leave their homes, sometimes with very little notice and without regard to their personal circumstances. Some have been in their properties for years, sometimes decades, home where their children have grown up, where their neighbours are friends, and where their lives have been rooted. At these times, I often ask myself how I would feel in that position. Lost, scared, and confused, I think, would be the answer. That's why this consultation on a new deal for tenants is so necessary and so right, and I profoundly disagree with Jeremy Balfour on rent controls. Tenants need to know that their tenancies are secure and that they can call the place where they live home by personalising it to their taste, and that they will not be faced with exorbitant rent rises that they can't afford and which would inevitably lead them into debt. Make no doubt about it, many private tenants are paying high rents, usually much more than a mortgage, for poor quality homes, and we've heard that from across the chamber. The latest report from Citizens Advice Bureau states that under the category problems during a tenancy, figures have gone up by 54% since the start of lockdown in 2020. Lockdown has shown us all the value of a secure and suitable home, and this consultation, in conjunction with the Scottish Green Party, is the start of the conversation to ensure a new and better deal for tenants will be delivered. Unlike the previous private rented sector strategy, this strategy will pursue a whole sector approach, considering the social and private rented sections together. Because housing tenures are integrated across the same neighbourhoods and even the same buildings, and all tenants have the right to a safe, warm, affordable and suitable home, regardless of the form their tenancy takes. Presiding Officer, while the aim of the Scottish Government to provide a further 110,000 affordable homes by 2032 is exemplary, there's no doubt that we need the private sector rental houses and responsible landlords for the foreseeable future. Of course, the housing shortage we're experiencing was born from Margaret Thatcher and her Tory government's disastrous policy of selling off council houses. What a legacy to leave future generations now struggling to put a roof over their heads. The New Deal recognises those difficulties, and this much needed agreement will help people in all aspects of renting a home. It aims to increase penalties for illegal evictions and restrict them during winter. It will give tenants greater flexibility to personalise their homes and keep pets, and that is crucial in my view. Why should tenants be denied the rights to enhance their lives that homeowners take for granted? Rent controls for the private rented sector and a new housing standard will apply, along with a regulator to ensure the system is fair for landlords and renters. Crucially, it will also set minimum standards for energy efficiency, making homes cheaper to heat and helping climate change targets. The measures form part of the Housing to 2040 strategy published in March this year, and they take forward several commitments made in the cooperation agreement with the Scottish Green Party. The results of the consultation will feed into the final version of the strategy to be published next year, with elements of the proposals put to the Scottish Parliament in a housing bill in 2023. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I know everyone across the chamber agrees that a warm, affordable home is a basic human right, a right that's been denied to too many people for far too long. So I welcome this new commitment to a new deal for renters, and I hope it will ease anxiety and give security to Scotland's 1.85 million people living in rented premises. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Mercedes Villalba, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Ms Villalba is joining us remotely. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The pandemic has exposed what decades of failed housing policy have done to the rented sector in Scotland. Many tenants are being driven into debt by unaffordable rents and being forced to live in damp, cold, poor quality housing. So I welcome the publication of the Scottish Government's consultation on a new deal for tenants. But let's be clear that it's thanks to activists in tenants' unions like Living Rent and campaigning MSPs like Pauline McNeill with her Fair Rents Bill that we're even seeing proposals for rent controls in the current consultation. I'm concerned by the Scottish Government's approach to implementing a rent control system. Their cooperation agreement with the Green Party commits to introducing rent controls by the end of 2025. But that means tenants will be waiting another 4 years for action to be taken on rent prices. And it means that landlords will have another 4 years to raise rents with impunity. Living Rent is calling for urgent action from the Scottish Government. In support of that, our Labour amendment calls for a commitment that the legislation establishing the framework for rent controls be included in the Housing Bill in the second year of this Parliament, and I hope every member today will support this. The Minister indicated earlier in the debate that no change in legislation could come until the consultation has concluded. But we're in the middle of an unaffordability crisis, and every month that rent controls are delayed is another month of increasing debt and insecure homes for renters. So I'd like to ask the Minister to look again at what urgent interim measures can be brought forward to help address unaffordable rents right now. Rent controls are also going to be vital if we're going to improve the quality of rented accommodation and the security of tenure. Scotland's housing stock is in a state of disrepair, with every second home failing the Scottish Government's own quality standards. But tenants have no real power to force landlords to make repairs, and too often complaints are met with a threat of eviction. Because even if a landlord can evict someone with a no-fault eviction, they can still use cost as a weapon to pressure tenants out by increasing rent. In countries such as Germany and the Netherlands, rent controls are used to force improvements and repairs in rented housing. So we should adopt a similar approach in Scotland, with rent controls serving to both incentivise improvements and deter unscrupulous landlords from refusing to make repairs or hiking up rents to secure evictions. The issue of unaffordable rent is not unique to the private rented sector. In 2019, the Scottish Housing Regulator found that up to 80% of tenants in the social and public rented sector were concerned about their ability to pay rent. Too many social landlords leave tenants with no choice but to accept rent increases. So we must democratise social landlords, putting tenants at the heart of their decision making. That's why the Scottish Government must make rent consultation statutory and their results binding on registered social landlords. Deputy Presiding Officer, although my remarks today have focused on the need for rent controls and proper consultation on rents, these measures cannot be implemented in isolation. They must be matched by significant improvements in enforcement, and measures which enhance tenants' rights, like ending the practice of tenant reference fees. And given that landlords received 14 times more in financial support than tenants during the pandemic, the Scottish Government now needs to prove to tenants that it is on their side by introducing these changes as a matter of urgency. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now move to closing speeches. I note that two members are not in the chamber, which is a discourtesy not just to the chair, but to other members in the debate, and I wouldn't expect an apology from each of them. I call Willie Rennie. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think this has been quite a good debate. I've enjoyed many of the contributions this afternoon. They've been quite enlightening. But I do wonder what's happened to Finlay Carson, because he went all cuddly this afternoon about cats and dogs, and that's not the character that I'm used to with Finlay Carson, perhaps because we are sitting in this chamber of the chamber now, that he's gone all soft. Perhaps he's had too much of the sherry in advance of Christmas. But nevertheless, it was a good contribution, because I think it actually got across how much people really care about cats and dogs, and especially when they're going through periods of self-isolation. I think these things are incredibly important. And it fed into what Audrey Nicholl was talking about, which was the health and well-being, and as somebody who's particularly passionate about the need for improved mental health support, I think it is incredibly important that we do take account the impact on people's mental health of poor housing. But it was Emma Roddick's contribution that I thought was particularly powerful this afternoon. From personal experience, she talked about, with actually quite a lot of knowledge about the interoperability of different parts of the housing sector, about holiday lets, short-term lets, about second homes, about absent landlords, and the impact that that has on people, particularly in remote and rural communities that she represents. But also, I was full of admiration when she spoke directly to the Scottish Government about the need to improve supply. And supply is at the heart of our amendment this afternoon, which I hope the Government is able to support, because if they do, we'll be able to support the main motion. I think it was a good debate, because we have got into some of the complex issues that are at the heart of this debate. I was interested in evictions, because, of course, we want to minimise evictions as much as we possibly can. But it's interesting reading the briefings from both Shelter and the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, where they address this from slightly different perspectives. Obviously, the Federation are keen to keep the tool of evictions as a last resort in order to make sure they can address people who are just simply refusing to pay their rent, even though they can afford to do so. They're trying to keep it down to a minimum. Where, on the other hand, you've got Shelter, who are saying that in the socially rented sector there are still far too many evictions, and they're also concerned about illegal evictions in the private rented sector. But even Shelter admit that we do need to keep the tool of evictions in order to have a last resort. Of course, they focus on the need to use best practice to make sure that we can avoid people getting into the situations where they're not paying their rent, but they still nevertheless regard evictions as an important part of the tool that landlords should have available to them. So I'd be keen to understand from the Minister exactly how that all fits together to make sure that we do spread best practice, but we don't deny the tools of control to make sure that those who are supposed to pay rent and can afford to pay rent are actually paying the rent that they are due. Second homes. Second homes is a big issue in North East Fife, and I know many constituencies across the country. We've dealt with the short-term lets in recent legislation. I know there's still some bits of that that have got to be finally resolved in terms of the licensing. But nevertheless, we've dealt with an important part of the housing market that's contributing to major problems in coastal and remote communities. But the other part is second homes. And there are some parts of my constituency where combined short-term lets and second homes accounts for something like 80% of the community. Now, how on earth are you supposed to keep a thriving community together with local shops and a school and public services in
the
a
member's
second,
about to conclude
and,
his remarks,
and buses if we do not have efforts to deal with second homes? And I was interested in the 2040 plan, which includes a reference to more powers for local authorities. but it's scant on details, and I'd be really interested to understand from the Minister what more is going to come forward and how quickly it's going to come forward, because this is an urgent situation that needs to be addressed for coastal and remote and rural communities. Thank you, Deputy
Thank
Presiding
you. I now call on Paul Sweeney to wind up for Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's been a really interesting debate because it described something that is the heart of Scottish politics and has been for over a century, the tension of power in our economy between landlordism and tenants' rights, and it's been a perpetual struggle that has been borne out over decades, and it is something that is very much at the heart of why this Parliament was established, and it's something that we need to confront boldly and with imagination. And in that spirit, that's why Scottish Labour welcomes the publication of the draft rental sector strategy and will seek to drive that forward with encouragement and support, but also inject some pace with our proposed amendment, and I hope the Minister will meet that with the spirit in which it is intended. And that was a good insight to the start of the debate. And I think we've had some very good contributions. Of course, we are working against the clock. The pressure on tenants is rising by the day. Indeed, over the last decade, we've seen rent increases in Edinburgh of 46% and in Glasgow of 41%. So we know that the longer this takes, the more pressure people are under as incomes continue to stagnate, as continued cost pressures are experienced by the population, something is going to have to give, and it often is the mental well-being, the security, and the fundamental ability of people to live their lives with a sense of well-being. So we have to act urgently to address this housing crisis in our midst. And that was described by many members. Of course, we are seeing the symptoms of this rising. Of course, we've seen in the last few years, in fact, in the last couple of years with the pandemic, even with the temporary ban on evictions, once that was removed, we saw social rental evictions increase due to arrears of 975%. So that's an explosive growth in pressure. And of course, we have estimates that the total social and private sector rental arrears has climbed to over £300 million. So major pressure, and that was described by Ms Balba from North East Region. The crisis point is something we can't wait to address. And of course, Paul McNeill, my colleague from Glasgow, addressed the point about short-term measures that can be implemented, such as looking at protecting the renters' rights of the 2020 COVID legislation, alongside the extending powers to end evictions in certain circumstances where there isn't anything related to antisocial or disruptive or criminal behaviour. I think it is unreasonable to expect that kind of particular situation where the community is seeing people displaced from their homes, ratcheted out of accommodation because of private landlordism, resulting in homelessness. That is something that society cannot accept. It's a cost that isn't priced in to how we deal with this, and it's not something the community as a whole should bear for the sake of private profit. Now, the Scottish Government are proposing rent controls, which we welcome in principle, but our amendment, of course, calls for the Government to agree to move faster and agree framework legislation in year two of this parliamentary term. And our amendment, which I understand the Minister is prepared to accept, is very welcome indeed, and I hope we can work constructively to deliver that framework with the pace, mindful of the pressures that renters are under. And of course, we've heard about how much insecure tenancy affects people's lives. Indeed, members who have personal experience have offered some pretty stirring testimony to that effect. And I think we also can understand that there are pressures that other people have to discuss rent controls. And I think we have to actually understand what we mean by rent controls. Rent controls exist, but the control lies with the landlord, not the tenant. This is an effort to try to redress that balance of control. Control is a constant thing. It's a question of who has the control, and that's what rent controls seek to address. I noted that there was a question about dogmatism. Well, I say, let us look at the evidence then. I know that the member for Lothians, the Conservative member for Lothians, raised this point. Yes, we are dogmatic about ending poverty and ending the income-related issues that push people into homelessness and all sorts of other distress as a result of housing costs that are completely out of control as a result of landlordism. So we have to address this urgently in our society, and we know that it can work because there are practical models. There have been ones that are flawed. Indeed, in Scotland, there were rent controls from 1915 in Glasgow up until 1989, which resulted in significant issues in the city. But we've learned from that experience, and there are models now internationally which we can benchmark against, and that's hopefully what the intended legislation is seeking to achieve. For example, in New York, there's been rent controls since the 1940s. They haven't resulted in the sort of calamitous effects that were described by the Conservative benches. Indeed, in San Francisco, there is an issue because pre-1980 properties are subject to rent controls, but those after 1980 aren't. That creates a perversity in the market, which causes distortions. That can be addressed. What you're describing is a sort of false equivalence, because it is not the case that it is a constant, that all rent controls are bad. It is that the devil is in the detail, and we hope to address all that through the course of this legislation. That's why Labour supports it. So we broadly support the principles behind the Living Rent campaign around the issue of democratic accountability. I think that was mentioned by the member for East Lothian in particular, the legacy of the right to buy scheme causing distortions in the market. Of course, Scotland at one point had the highest level of social tenancies in the world. In fact, I think in Glasgow it was second only to Hong Kong worldwide for social rented tenancies. We've seen a massive disruption and change in the marketplace over the last 40 years that we have to address. Things are out of control. And I think we have seen numerous descriptions by members today about the impact that has had, the lack of control by tenancies, the lack of control from the public sector, the rampaging profiteering that goes on in the market that has to be addressed. And we hope to work constructively as we go forward in the coming months and years to address this with urgency and boldly and with imagination. Let's redress the power of rent controls from the landlord to the tenant.
Thank you. I now call on Alexander Stewart to wind up for the Conservatives. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to close this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Today we've heard many contributions about the importance of protecting and enhancing tenants' rights, and I welcome that we've had time to debate this today. All too often the rented sector and tenants themselves have become a forgotten element of the wider debate around housing. And now there is certainty and opportunity. And over the last 2 years, the pandemic has shone a light on many of the challenges focused by tenants up and down the length and breadth of the country. And in response to that, last year's Coronavirus Act included measures to protect tenants, both in the social and private rented sectors, from evictions. And that was very much welcomed, and the period went from 3 to 6 months. Similarly, in the second Coronavirus Act, we talked about students who are stuck in rental contracts, and they were protected due to the COVID pandemic. Measures such as these are entirely justified, and these benches did not hesitate to support these, Presiding Officer. But it's right that going forward, the conversation now shifts, and we talk about supporting tenants in long term, and we look towards Scotland's recovery from the pandemic. And there is much in the rented sector strategy that we can welcome, including measures to prevent illegal evictions and evictions during winter months. But although these protections are there, evictions are also talking about what happens to tenants and themselves. And there's a gap in the rental market and the schemes that is proposed that new tenancies provide financial guarantees to cover the cost of deposits, for example. And it's perhaps disappointing that such a scheme isn't included in the proposals that we're debating today. But going forward, it's clear there is main issues facing tenants, and that's spiralling rents. And within my own area in Fife and Forth Valley, my own region, they have seen some of the largest increases. In two-bedroom properties, a 5% increase alone, but over a 30% increase since 2010. And when you look at three bedrooms, it's 40% that you're looking at. But when it comes to four bedrooms, Fife have seen an increase of 72% since 2010 and 16.5% in the last year alone. Such statistics make it clear that increasing rents are going to be one of the main challenges focused on tenants, and as we look forward to that. While conversations about increasing tenants' rights are very important, there needs to be a plan to talk about increasing housing. Tenants do indeed have the right for protections, but there also needs to be the rights to ensure going forward. And while we talk about the proposals that will come towards the end of 2025, Presiding Officer, we should not suppose that that is a one-stop solution to ensuring that rents will be managed. It's also the fact that we've looked at what is happening in the rental market. And we talked about some examples, and examples have been made of other parts of the country and around the world. But Sweden, for example, where rent controls have been contributed, that has ensured that there's a second sublet property market, and there has been waiting lists of over a decade. In an attempt to fix one problem on the rental market, we should not inadvertently create one other. So it's vitally important that we manage the situation. However, experience tells us that we should not try to push through proposals such as these without considering the potential pitfalls. Presiding Officer, we've had some very good contributions across the chamber this afternoon, and I'd like to talk on some of them. My colleague Miles Briggs spoke about the need to increase supply of homes in Scotland and the supply of rental properties and these rental controls. Also, the pressure zones, they have to be examined in this whole process about what can happen, because market levels and market rents will take place. Will there be any talk about the increase of supply of affordable housing? And also, the key to that was ensuring that the supply was the priority. And I do believe that is the case. Finlay Carson talked about the complexities of the issue, and we acknowledge that there are massive complexities when trying to manage this. Rentals need to have responsible tenants, and there are many responsible tenants, and there are many responsible landlords. But he talked about the pet-friendly rentals. Now, that is an issue that has been brought to the fore during this pandemic, and there is a play within the sector for that part when we're dealing with social isolation and loneliness. And Jeremy Balfour talked about the difficulties that the market faced, the short-term assessments that should not be short-sighted. And there is an element of ensuring that we don't fall into that trap, that we do understand the needs of the workforce and how sustainable they should be and can be to ensure that that takes place. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, these benches here welcome the efforts to enhance and protect tenants' rights, and we have set out an appropriate timescale for doing that. And there will be opportunities for people to contribute during this process. The key focus for this government needs to be on investment in the housing sector more generally. The bigger problem facing renters will be the lack of rental properties and maintaining a sustainable investment. And that's what the government should do and to ensure that change does take place. Going forward, it is appropriate that tenants' needs to be looked at. And we will approach that and continue to call for that to ensure that there's a balance, there is an opportunity, and there is a structure that supports the sector and enhances the sector. And I look forward to the debate and discussion that will take place going forward. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I now call the Minister to wind up for the Scottish Government. Up to 8 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I thank all the members who've contributed to what I think has been a constructive debate. There are clearly some issues of substance that we'll disagree on, some calling for us not to do certain things, others saying we're not going nearly fast enough. We'll have those debates and perhaps those disagreements, and that's all legitimate. But I wanted to pull out one point that I think came across from right across the spectrum, first of all. I think there were a number of speeches from all parties that recognised the importance of home, and that's something that we've learned more about and understood at a deeper level in these days of COVID, when more people have had to work from home or been isolated and being kind of cooped up together, and the necessity that we have to make that right to adequate housing a real delivered human right in our society, and recognising that not everybody has that right to adequate housing being met, it's really important. And so recognising the meaning and the importance of home, I think, is really important. And residential properties are not principally speculative investments. They are not principally substitute pensions. They are principally homes. That's what they're for. And that really must be our priority. So I hope going forward, whatever differences we might have on points of detail and individual policies, I hope that we'll all continue to stick to that principle and to work toward the realisation of housing, adequate housing, as a human right and something that has to be met everywhere. I want to, in the time that I've got available, run through some of the contributions and obviously in particular talk about some of about all of the amendments that we'll be voting in. The Conservative contribution from Miles Briggs opening for the party, obviously we disagree on some fundamentals, but there were some important points of agreement as well there, not least thanking the organisations who've sent briefings. Many of them have worked with me to help shape our thinking ahead of the publication of the strategy. And the Conservatives have expressed support for measures to support those who are experiencing or at risk of domestic abuse, as well as for action on illegal evictions. And I think I heard support for action on winter evictions as well. And if there are any points of common ground that we have there, I'll certainly look forward to working together on that. I don't agree with the Conservative amendment. I don't agree with the budget analysis that's in there. The focus, for example, on the Rural Housing Fund. The Rural Housing Fund is not, by a long way, the only way that social housing is provided in rural and island areas. And in fact, in the last Parliament, more than 6,000 social homes were provided in rural and island areas. And the amendment also deletes a lot of the ambition in our motion, so we won't be supporting that, but I give way.
Miles Briggs.
I appreciate the Minister giving way. It's a fact, though, which the Minister will have to accept, that the housing budget is being cut by £10 million.
Minister.
Well, I think that there are contesting analyses about how we look at the budget. That's always the case. Pretty much every year, political parties and analysts and others will try and cut and slice the budget in different ways to present their own particular preference. I won't be supporting that amendment. And I just wanted to touch on this point of disagreement about rent controls as well, about the principle of it. Miles Briggs asked, what assessment has already taken place? We are not yet at the point of having a fully developed proposal on rent controls. We are at the point of recognising the depth of the problem and the need for it to be addressed. And we are open to hearing all points of view on the particular design of a rent control system. We're being very, very clear. We need to gather far more data, detailed data on rent levels and on the other aspects of the private rented sector before we're able to design and present finalised proposals on that. And we will take an open mind. I'll take one more if I have time.
Miles Briggs.
Appreciate the Minister taking this. I also highlighted rent pressure zones and the complete failure we've seen for them to actually make any difference. So what assessment's taken place on that?
Minister.
Well, I think it's very clear that placing, as I said earlier, the onus, the whole responsibility at the local government level to generate the data, to produce an evidence base to show that rent pressure zones are necessary, is one of the fatal flaws in that system. And that's why I believe that an effective national system of rent controls is necessary. But the fixation on market values, on the operation of a free market, I think it's abundantly clear that a free market approach to housing has failed far too many people. And in any case, housing is not just a market commodity. Housing is a human right. There is a moral case for fair rent, which I believe is equal to the moral case for fair wages. Few people these days would question the need for a minimum wage and for the state to intervene in what would otherwise be an extremely exploitative free market. And I think the case that we need to make is every bit as clear. On Labour's, I do need to move on, I'm afraid. I'll come to Labour's position and recognise the long-standing case for intervention that's been made by Labour colleagues. I believe that our intention to lay the framework for the data collection machinery that we need, that will start building the case. That is what's to be proposed for the Year 2 Housing Bill. And I, from my exchange with Mark Griffin in the early part of the debate, I understood that that was what the intention of the motion, that the amendment was, and I'll support it on that basis. It is really clear that if we're going to take action, we need to take time to get the detail right. There will be elements of what's proposed in the strategy which will take through to 2025, to the end of this, or near the end of this Parliament. There will also be measures such as on rent adjudication which will happen much earlier, and I hope that we'll continue to work with Labour colleagues on that. And I want to recognise as well Pauline McNeill's long-standing work on this issue and thank her for the opportunity to work constructively, and I'd be very happy to do that. Let's be really clear. This is not about saying no change till 2025. Very far from it. It's about saying there will be a schedule of work beginning in the short term and working through to 2025, for example, on pre-action protocols, as Mark Griffin also mentioned. On student accommodation, there is a review on that, and I'll write to Pauline McNeill with more detail on that. And the Liberal Democrat contribution as well, Willie Rennie recognised the level of cold, damp, overpriced properties that are still out there, recognising the reality of the problems that this strategy is seeking to address. A lot of his focus was on social renting. We were clearly on target to pre-pandemic to meet our delivery targets for social housing. The pandemic has provided a massive challenge to everybody in relation to the construction sector. But the 110,000 target is, I want to make it clear, a very clear commitment. And as far as I understood Willie Rennie's amendment, he's not seeking to up that to an arbitrary and unfunded target, but just putting pressure on us to deliver that target we've committed to. And on that basis, I would certainly like to support that amendment. If I have time for one more...
The Minister has 8 minutes and is closing now.
Okay. Well, in that case, Presiding Officer, can I once again thank all those who've contributed to our thinking in developing the strategy, contributed to the debate. I think it's very clear that Scotland is on a journey to a much fairer position for tenants in Scotland, in both the private and the social rented sectors, as well as in those perhaps more niche, unconventional areas of rented accommodation. So I invite Parliament to share my ambition for tenants in Scotland, for a new deal for tenants to make that fairer Scotland possible, and to support the government amendment as well as the Labour and Liberal Democrat the government motion as well as the Labour and Liberal Democrat amendments. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on a new deal for tenants, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of a legislative consent motion. And I ask Keith Brown to move motion number 2618 on Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Bill UK legislation.
Formally move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of three Parliamentary Bureau motions, and I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 2651, 2652 and 2653 on suspension and variation of standing orders.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and all moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time, and there are six questions to be put as a result of today's business. And can I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Miles Briggs is agreed to, the amendment in the name of Mark Griffin will fall? And the first question is that amendment 2625.1 in the name of Miles Briggs, which seeks to amend motion 2625 in the name of Patrick Harvey on a new deal for tenants, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.